The story often, and this is often the way with, you know, wars that are being fought around the world, that our side, be it the Australian, the American, whatever, gets told again and again and again, but the story of the people who are victim to what's going on doesn't get told in a personal way. Like they might get told that, you know, the Iraqi people or the Afghanis or whatever, as a mass, as a sort of faceless, voiceless mass. But I really liked the idea of giving voice to these people as individuals, making them real, showing them as people with families, with lives, with emotions, humanising them. Hajj Ali ran an organisation for victims of abuse in American prisons, basically anyone who'd been in, well, starting with Abu Ghraib because he'd been there, and then it sort of grew. He helped put us in touch with other people, and through him we met Abu Man. And interviewed him. Their suffering and their pain hadn't been acknowledged in an individual way, and I think it's such a horrifying experience that for them to actually have someone, especially from the West, especially Australia was at war then as well, so and I was Australian, so you know, we were part of the invading and occupying forces. I suppose they felt validated, perhaps, to have people talking to them about it, and they wanted people to know what had happened to them, because when they were in Abu Ghraib, it was so much, they were so shut off from the outside world, and until the photos were released, no one really knew what was happening. Asking anyone to recount stories of suffering is pretty awful, and it's that fine line you run as a journalist between wanting to get the story because you think the story is important and might help affect some kind of change, and knowing that you are putting people through suffering again, and I was. And he knew, it's kind of a pact. He understood what I was doing, but it is a fine line. When I was researching the story about the soldiers who witnessed and were involved in the abuse at Abu Ghraib, I came across someone who had the disc of all the photographs, and I asked for them, and I was given them. I spoke to one journalist, a journalist with a very big US publication, had the full set, and I knew he had the set, and I spoke to him. I couldn't tell him I had the photos at the time, but I asked him why he thought they hadn't been released if other people had them, and he said that he thought they served no purpose and that it would just be damaging to troops on the ground in Iraq. I disagreed with him. I thought the photos showed that there was systemic abuse, because the US government had claimed that there was just a few bad apples after the first photos were released, and they were somehow getting away with that, just sending a handful of people to court and holding them to account for it. And I think the photos showed, they showed a lot more serious, they showed murder, they showed a lot more serious abuses, and they also showed that it was extraordinarily widespread. I think knowing that the photos would be used to shed light on what had been happening at Abu Ghraib and hopefully change what had happened or hold people to account made it easier to deal with looking at the content. But it is very graphic, and it was very disturbing. And that's just part of the job in a way. You just sort of deal with it, talk to someone about it, try and compartmentalise it a bit. But probably more disturbing than looking at the photos is talking to the people and hearing their stories and seeing the lasting impact of their experiences. And I think that's the most important thing to try and do as a journalist, is try and give voice to the people who aren't being heard.